This is Where We Live on Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchel. Registered voters should not overlook primaries. This year, primary day is Tuesday, September 14th, and in some cities, that means voting in races for mayor. Today, we talk to the Democratic candidates running to unseat four-term incumbent New Britain Mayor Aaron Stewart, a Republican. State Representative Bobby Sanchez is a Democratic Party's endorsed candidate. The New Britain native is a longtime state lawmaker. He chairs the legislature's Education Committee. And before being elected in 2011 to the General Assembly, he was a member of the New Britain Board of Education. Alicia Hernandez-Strong is also a New Britain native who collected enough signatures to be on the primary ballot. She's a community activist who worked for Congresswoman Hayes' first campaign, and she was executive director of the Council on American Islamic Relations for Connecticut. Alicia is also the founder of the New Britain Racial Justice Coalition. Now, if you're a New Britain resident, we want to hear from you. What questions do you have for these candidates? Join us at 888-720-9677. That's 888-720-WMPR. You can share a comment or question on our Facebook page or find us on Twitter at Where We Live. Alicia and Representative Bobby Sanchez, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Now, we're starting on Zoom today, and I know today is the first day back for so many students, including in New Britain. Alicia, I'll start with you. I understand that you went to New Britain schools as a child, and when we look back at this pandemic, we're still in it a year and a half later. What do you think is the biggest challenge facing students right now?
Yeah, I think there are a lot of challenges that are being compounded this year. I mean, New Britain already ranks at the bottom in per pupil spending. We already struggle to fund the things that students need. So I think the pandemic just adds another layer to it. The digital divide is very real. There are many students who don't have access to Wi-Fi, reliable Wi-Fi to go to school. So I am definitely worried about the potential for going back online and students falling behind like what happened last year. And I'm also really concerned about the uptake in cases here in New Britain. New Britain is one of the lowest vaccinated cities here in Connecticut. So seeing kids go back to school, I think a lot of parents and families are worried about the spread of COVID with the new Delta variant. So we definitely need to invest in safety and cleaning measures, but I think generally we also need to start addressing the digital divide and making sure that students have everything they need to prosper.
Representative Sanchez, you were once a member of the Board of Education in New Britain. Obviously, you're chair of the legislature's Education Committee, as I mentioned, but you used to be a preschool teacher at one point in your career. And so education is also front and center for you as a campaign issue. And what are you most concerned about this year?
Well, thank you, Lucy. Yes, definitely. I'm very concerned with the social emotional state of children that are going to be coming into school this year. It's something that we discussed in our education committee meetings numerous times. We also passed legislation to help and bring some guidance and ask the State Department of Education to provide some guidance to the local Board of Eds on how to go about working with children and their social and emotional needs. Very concerned, of course, with what's going on with connectivity, with the digital divide that happened last year. I think they're a little more prepared this time around, although there are still some flaws in the system. That's something that we also on the Education Committee addressed so that we can reach out to localities and find out what materials are needed. A lot of the federal funding that came in, the guidance was from SDE to invest in some of these laptops and Chromebooks and to look into the connectivity issues that are going on, particularly in cities like New Britain. So I think those things are currently being looked at and have been worked on, but nothing is perfect. I still believe there's going to be some issues, but I'm glad that the children are going back to school. I talked to numerous students. They were excited to be back into school because they get to meet their friends and meet their teachers. It's not the same. It's not the same to be at home remote learning versus being in the classroom. Mm-hmm. So it affected a lot of children. the fact that New Britain is so behind has a lot to do, of course, with the lack of funding that the city does not do enough investment in education. And so, that's going to be one of my really big issues to tackle here in the city of New Britain. I think the mayor has not, her and her administration at this point are not communicating very well. And there's some big issues within the Board of Education and the administration in regards to communication and what the needs are for our children. So,
Representative and Alicia, I just wanted to ask you both, since you're running to become mayor, what should be the mayor's relationship with the Board of Ed, and how would you describe it right now with the current mayor? I'll start with you, Alicia.
Yeah, I mean, right now what we're seeing is we're seeing a lot of conflict between City Hall and the Board of Education. And I think that's really dangerous because both bodies are important to ensuring that our children have resources. On the mayoral and city council side, it's important that we make sure our students have all of the resources they need to be successful and to thrive. And on the Board of Education side, it's important to make sure we have all the policies and plans in place to make sure that money is used wisely. I think right now the tense relationship between City Hall and the Board of Ed is ultimately hurting our students. I think there needs to be collaboration, not only with the Board of Ed and City Hall, but also generally statewide and with other cities similar to New Britain in size, because this problem with funding is both a city and a state issue. The fact that property taxes fund education is the prime reason why a community like New Britain doesn't have the funds they need. So I think creating these connections and building a broader coalition to fight for more funding would be beneficial not only to New Britain, but to cities across the state.
Representative Sanchez, you've been a longtime state lawmaker. I know some listeners, when they hear talk about more funding, they wonder about how the funding is used. And is there enough scrutiny in what's being invested in when we still see outcomes that are problematic? How do you address that?
Well, you know, between the Board of Education, the administration, and the mayor's office, the communication is not happening. It hasn't been happening now for a number of years. And that's really serious. You have to have a mayor and you have to have a superintendent and an administration that connects and communicates so that we know what exactly is happening in our school system, what policies need to be changed in order to make our school system better. Those talks are not happening. That communication is lacking. At the state level, we have listened, and with educational cost sharing in the past 3 years, we have managed to put in additional dollars on the state level to the city of New Britain. In the last 2 years, New Britain received close to $10 million additional dollars in ECS funding. And in the biennium budget that we just passed, we added an additional $10 million. On the state side, we're moving along and providing that funding. On the city side, though, the flat funding has hurt tremendously. This is why you have large classrooms where you have more than 25 students in a classroom with one teacher. You can't hire enough teachers. You can't hire enough paraprofessionals. I mean, there are certain issues that that really need to be looked into, and the policies are very important. But you can't make change if the administrations on both sides are not communicating. That is key. You have to communicate. You have to work together. That is not happening right now.
You can join our conversation if you're a New Britain resident. We're talking with two candidates who will be on the Democratic mayoral primary ballot on September 14th. That is Representative Bobby Sanchez, who you just heard, and Alicia Hernandez Strong. Here's the number to join us, 888-720-9677. That's 888-720-WMPR, or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. Clarissa's calling in first. Clarissa, go ahead.
My question to Representative Sanchez and Representative Alicia would be, how do they feel about the Christopher Columbus Memorial, what it stands for? Do they feel like if they were elected, it would be removed? Because in my opinion, it's it's just a memorial of a spirit of oppression, and New Britain is the only one that hasn't stood up to remove it. So I'd like to know how you guys feel about that.
Thank you, Clarissa, for your question. And for context for our listeners, I believe the council had voted to remove that statue, and the current mayor, New Britain Mayor Aaron Stewart, vetoed that. So I'll start with you first, Alicia.
Yeah, that's an excellent question. I'm actually one of the people who spearheaded the movement to remove the Columbus statue, because I recognize that almost 40% of residents identify as Puerto Ricans. And a lot of the brutality that Columbus committed actually happened on the island of Puerto Rico to the indigenous people. So through my organization, the New Britain Racial Justice Coalition, we rallied members of the community from all different cultural groups and affinities. And we said, this is unacceptable. We cannot continue to walk by this statue. We led protests, we led call-ins. We were actually able to flip some Republican counselors to get this passed, and ultimately Aaron Stewart vetoed it. As mayor, I am committed to removing it. I don't think it represents who we are as a city. In fact, I think it represents this old idea of separating people by ethnicity and race in the city, instead of bringing people together along things that are similar. Most people in New Britain are working class people, but I think that this often gets lost in these politics around things like statues. But I am definitely committed to removing the statue as someone who led that movement just a year ago here in New Britain.
Representative Sanchez, how would you address this issue for the city?
Well, again, this is what's happening in the current administration. You're supposed to be listening to the people. People rallied. People got together, petitions were turned in, people went to public participation and asked for its removal. And most of the council did vote in favor of removing it, and then the mayor vetoes it. When I take office in November, I'm gonna tell you this, I'm going to be listening to the people. If the people want the statue removed, we will remove the statue. Right now, the school board did make a decision that they're not celebrating Columbus Day. They're celebrating Indigenous People Day in October. I think they started that last year, and they're going to continue. They were criticized for that, but they made the move, and they listened to the children, the students, and the people when they voiced their concerns at public hearings at the Board of Ed. So this is what we have to do. The people are the voice in the city of New Britain. And if you're not going to listen to them, then there's an issue.
Again, you can join us if you're a New Britain resident. We're talking with two candidates running on the Democratic primary ballot for mayor, Representative Bobby Sanchez, a longtime state lawmaker, a New Britain native, and also Alicia Hernandez-Strong, a New Britain native who collected enough signatures to be on the ballot. She's running on what she calls the people's slate. Again, that number, 888-720-9677. That's 888-720-WMPR. Before I take another caller question, as I'm listening to both of you, you seem like you have pretty similar stances on particular issues. And so I'm wondering if you could set yourself apart from your opponent. Alicia, for people who are listening, why should they vote for you over Representative Sanchez?
Yeah, so I have made real tangible commitments, and I have proposed a long-term vision for the city of New Britain. For the last 6 months, I've been putting out extensive policy platforms that not only explain in vague generalities what I might do, like increase education or support affordable housing, but actual steps on how I'm going to do that, how I'm going to keep track of that, and how I'm going to fund that. And I think that's what we need from our elected officials. We need a long-term plan. For so long, politicians have come in and only thought as far as their two-year term, and that's put New Britain in jeopardy. So I think that it's important to elect someone with a long-term plan. I also think it's important to elect someone who is grassroots and who is in touch with the people. I'm a community activist in New Britain, and I've been so for a number of years. I'm in touch with a number of people, working class people in the city, and I think we need a politician who really has that connection. So my plans and my platform, coupled with my connection to the people, makes me uniquely qualified to lead this city.
Representative Sanchez.
Yes, well, I'm born and raised here in the city of New Britain, went to school, was a teacher here in the city of New Britain, worked in the city of New Britain the most of my life, and represented been representing New Britain now for the past 10 years at the state level. I've advocated for education. I've advocated for working families. My degree is in human services. I have been working in the human services field now for 40 years of my life. Dedicated to working with children, dedicated to working with families. That's the work I've done. I ran a 19-year program, a fatherhood initiative program to connect fathers with their children, fathers that have come out of incarceration and are left out in the cold. Basically, they're not connected to housing services or employment. I've helped many dads connect with their families. This is all who I am. I've dedicated my whole life working with families and working with children. And the policies that I work at the state level have always been how we benefit our children and how we benefit our families, our working class families here in the state of Connecticut. And so this is the person I am. And I bring the experience that's needed at City Hall. I will step in on the first day, roll up my sleeves and get to work.
Again, you can join us 888-720-9677 as we talk with the two Democratic candidates, again, running on the Democratic primary ballot, rather, for mayor. That's September 14th in New Britain, 888-720-9677. Sam's calling in. Sam, what's your question?
Hi. If Mayor Stewart can't control the police department, why should I believe one of you can?
Alicia, do you want to go first?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think it has to do with political will, quite frankly. I think that's what we're dealing with right now. Last year, when the Black Lives Matter movement reignited across the nation, I was one of the first people right here in New Britain to push for police accountability. Again, with my organization, we proposed a comprehensive plan, well-researched and well-thought-out, to ensure that any police misconduct in the city would be referred to a civilian review board that would ensure that nobody was abusing any citizen. Of course, the Republican council and mayor quickly struck that down. But I want to emphasize that it is a political will to do things or to not do things. So it's not a matter of Erin Stewart can't control the police, but it's a matter of she's not willing to. And I've shown that I'm taking the initiative to push for police accountability like so many young activists are around the country, because I grew up in this town and I want to make sure everybody is treated fairly and everybody can feel safe in New Britain.
Alicia, the caller described the police department as out of control. Do you believe that? And can you point to some examples?
Yes, I am extremely concerned with a lot of the behaviors of the police department. In my capacity as an organizer in the New Britain Racial Justice Coalition, we work in a lot of low-income areas. And what I hear a lot of times from people is that they feel that they are actually being targeted by police officers. I also hear this from homeless folks who live in our town who are often in Central Park, saying that they always have to deal with police harassment. I think this is completely unacceptable, and I'm really concerned. You know, there are a number of incidents that have me extremely worried. You know, Zoe Dow Dow was killed by the New Britain Police Department a few years back. We had an incident in 2019 where an SRO arrested a young student with behavioral problems in front of the whole school. So these incidents continue to occur, but because of the system, there's not a mechanism for maintaining accountability. Additionally, I am very concerned with the military police equipment that has been acquired by the New Britain Police Department. Currently, the New Britain Police Department has over $1 million in military equipment, which includes an MRAP, or a mine-resistant vehicle. Last time I checked, there are no mines in New Britain, so I'm confused why New Britain taxpayers are paying to maintain military vehicles that have no use in our communities. So these types of issues really need to be addressed, and we need somebody who is willing to address them. Because quite frankly, a lot of politicians are afraid to even engage with the police and these issues of policing. As a Black Lives Matter activist since 2013, I definitely am not.
Representative Sanchez, we know that the General Assembly passed a police accountability bill, changing up training when use of force is permitted. And I'm wondering if you can respond to what the caller said. If you're elected as mayor, what would that relationship be between your office and the New Britain Police?
Well, the buck stops with the chief of the police department. And absolutely, last year when everything happened with George Floyd and the disgusting behavior by that police officer, the Black and Puerto Rican caucus up at the state capitol got together and we worked on a police accountability bill. We passed it, barely passed it out of the House and in the Senate, but it did pass. And we're holding police accountable by, number one, they have to have body cameras. It's so important that they have body cameras and they have them on while they're on duty. So there's, you know, they will get in trouble if they turn off those cameras while they have them on their bodies. The other thing that we talked about is we set policies from in that bill where it would allow cities to form these civilian review boards. And New Britain, one was brought up by the Democrats on the council. They tried to form it together, and of course it was turned down by the mayor. I truly believe there should be a civilian review board, and if I become mayor, that's definitely going to happen. But again, it all stops with the chief of police. If there are police officers that are not behaving and are breaking rules and policies, it's the chief's responsibility to make sure that they are getting the training that they're supposed to get. And we set forward some guidance on certain trainings with the police accountability bill as well. If they're not using those guidances, then you know, something's wrong with the administration at the police department, and that has to be dealt with. Would I bring in the chief and hold him accountable? Absolutely. If the work is not being done, then we have to hold the chief accountable, and because the buck stops there. Same thing, the buck stops with the mayor as well. The mayor is the leader of that city, the administrator of that city, and they have to ensure that the public feels safe and that the police department is being held accountable for their actions.
I should mention where we live has tried scheduling New Britain Mayor Aaron Stewart on the show a few times, and there have been some scheduling snags. We hope to get her on the show before the November election. Today, you're hearing from the candidates in the New Britain Democratic mayoral primary, Representative Bobby Sanchez and Alicia Hernandez-Strong. If you live in New Britain, here's your chance to ask these candidates questions before that primary, September 14th. Here's the number, 888-720-9677. That's 888-720-WMPR, or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. This is Where We Live on Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchel. We're talking to the Democratic candidates running to unseat four-term incumbent New Britain Mayor Aaron Stewart, a Republican. The primary is September 14th. State Representative Bobby Sanchez is the Democratic Party's endorsed candidate. He's a New Britain native, longtime state lawmaker. He chairs the legislature's Education Committee. Alicia Hernandez-Strong is also a New Britain native. She collected enough signatures to be on that primary ballot. She's a community activist. She worked for Congresswoman Hayes' first campaign. She was the executive director of the Council on American Islamic Relations for Connecticut, and she's the founder of the New Britain Racial Justice Coalition. Now, if you live in the city of New Britain, we want to hear from you. What questions do you have for these mayoral candidates? 888-720-9677. That's 888-720-WMPR. Or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. Now, Alicia and Representative Sanchez, we know this summer there's a lot of attention on New Britain after that runner and city resident, 53-year-old Henrik Gudelski, was hit and killed in New Britain by a teenager who was driving a stolen car. This teenager had been repeatedly been in trouble with the law We heard from Mayor Stewart and other Republicans in the state that said this case is an example of why more youth offenders who have a record like this young teenager did should be sent to adult court. And there should even be a new kind of criminal offense for stealing a motor vehicle. And so I'll start with you, Representative Sanchez. If you were mayor at the time of this tragedy, how would you have handled this situation?
Well, first of all, I would communicate with your delegation, not just a Republican delegation, but your Democratic delegation. There's three of us, and we also have a senator who's a Democrat. No communication whatsoever, not a telephone call about any issues that are happening in the city of New Britain. We haven't heard from her in years. So that's an issue itself. The fact that they hired a lobbyist firm to lobby us for the past couple of years, I don't understand. But anyway, in regards to Henry Kondelsky, it was a horrific tragedy. And that particular teenager or person has to be held, young man has to be held accountable for what he did. We at up there at the state capitol have been looking at different policies and how we could bring in more resources to help the youth, because it's, if you leave it up to certain Republicans, the way out is to lock them up and throw away the key. That's not how we do things. These are teenagers. We need to, once they have a first offense, we need to refer them to some mental health services or find out what are the resources that they need in order to keep them from doing this again. Now, that's not happening throughout the state. And instead of going up to the Capitol and rallying with Republicans, by the way, I haven't seen her in years up at the Capitol to rally about anything. Pointing fingers is not the way to do things. Sitting down with the stakeholders and coming up with solutions and how we can work around this and make sure that we're doing the right thing and providing the right resources, that's how we do things. That pointing finger stuff, that doesn't work. It throws people off and it's the wrong thing to do. You need to be communicating. As mayor, I will communicate with all the stakeholders, regardless of what party they're mm-hmm. from. They have to be at the table. We have to communicate. We have to talk about how we can turn the system around. One of the things that the governor implemented right away was to make sure that these judges were provided the information during the weekends, because apparently that was an issue. I didn't know that was an issue, but apparently that was an issue. And guess what? The governor worked on it immediately. We reached out to the governor's office to see why that was happening, and something was done about it. And presently there is a core group of people, bipartisan group of people that are working and looking at the juvenile court system and to look at improvements and policy changes. And I know that that'll come up in January when the next session it moves forward. So I believe things are starting to work. It's unfortunate what happened to Henry. And I can imagine how the family is feeling. It's tragedy. But that person that did that, committed that crime, will be held accountable.
Alicia, when we hear Representative Sanchez talk about investing in mental health services and also just services to help children who may get in trouble instead of sending them into the juvenile court system, because, statistics show that once a child is in the system, they're likely to reoffend and end up in adult prison. Nobody wants to see that, right? It's not good for anybody involved. But this is a conversation that has been going on for several years. And so I'm wondering, as mayor, if you're elected, how would you address, helping children who are committing certain crimes and ways to keep them out of the system?
Absolutely. I think our approach to juvenile crime and public safety in general needs to be one of prevention and proactivity and not being reactive. What we saw, what happened to this man was absolutely a tragedy, but the reaction from the Republicans was not based in any type of data or any type of research. They saw this death as a way to score political points and to scare people, to have people think that they are unsafe, and thus we need to put tougher penalties on these youth. I'm somebody who believes very much in data and believes very much in research. And so I believe that New Britain needs to end the school to prison pipeline and stop putting juveniles in jail, because like you said, that is only a short-term solution. You put them in jail now, and when they come out and they're not able to get a job because they have a record, and they're not able to get housing because they have a record, and they lose access to all of these things, then they come back in the community and it becomes an issue again. So you've only stopped that issue for a very short time. So I think there's a number of things we need to do to address juvenile crime. For example, instead of having two police officers in the schools, we need to start investing in social workers and mental health counselors and folks who can help. And I want to be clear that when I talk about mental health services, we need comprehensive in-community mental health services for the whole family. Oftentimes, I hear people saying, well, what about the parents? We need to go back to the parents. But the reality is the parents are often also dealing with a number of issues, whether they work a lot and are unable to access childcare and so can't watch their child, or maybe they struggle with addiction, or maybe they're incarcerated, right? And so we need to focus on healing the whole family by providing them with community services, not just the child. And once we're able to give that kind of support, that is a long-term solution to keep the child out of the system. You know, we cannot go back to 20 years ago when we were throwing kids in jail for everything, because I think what we're seeing here now is the repercussions of that. I'd be interested to see how many juvenile offenders have a close family member who is also incarcerated. We cannot keep creating these cycles of incarceration. We need to start supporting people. There is a reason why juveniles in wealthier areas tend to do better. Because when we have all of the resources we need, crime goes down. This is a fact. So as mayor, I think the mayor needs to address this and invest in this, invest in long-term public safety solutions. That is the only way. These reactionary responses will only hurt our community for decades and generations to come.
You mentioned data, Alicia. I know our investigative unit at Connecticut Public looked at data related to car thefts, and car thefts did spike in 2020. We know crime increased generally when the pandemic started. Some researchers blame the pandemic, you know, those support programs and other services not available while we're all in lockdown at one point. And so it'll be interesting to hear again how this issue is discussed from the state capitol on down. But I want to take another caller, and you can join us too as we talk to two candidates running for the Democratic mayoral primary. That's Alicia Hernandez Strong and State Representative Bobby Sanchez. The number 888-720-9677, or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. Christelle, are you there? What's your question?
Yes, hi. So I was just listening in, and both the candidates seem to be really interested in mental health services and supporting families and children, and that's totally great. And they seem to be very interested in bridging that gap between the community and the police department, and I think that's also really awesome. But one of the things that doesn't really get mentioned is actually supporting the good police officers that are kind of getting lumped in with, you know, the bad apples in the bunch. What resources do you guys plan on, you know, using to actually help bridge the divide and maybe help supporting maybe good police officers who are kind of put between a rock and a hard place and may potentially also be getting exposed to things that they're not getting help for, such as traumatic incidents as part of their job?
Thank you, Christelle. Representative Sanchez, do you want to go first?
Yes, I think you can hear me now, right?
Yes, go ahead.
So again, we need extensive training. And when we passed the accountability bill, we discussed about multiple training sessions for these police officers, because absolutely right, there are very good police officers. I know a number of them here in the city of New Britain. You know, they should not be held accountable for the actions of another police officer that really, you know, either didn't get the training or doesn't follow the rules. It all comes down again to what they do on a yearly basis to train these police officers before they even go out and to walk the beat or to do their jobs. They have to also understand, and I think the the fact that they have body cameras is going to be useful too, because the body cameras will also protect the police officer if he's accused of something that he actually did not do. And the camera is there. It's you know, that's evidence. But also the body camera will help weeding out those officers that have not followed the rules, similar to what happened to George Floyd in Minneapolis. So I think those are key. And we also, you know, going back to the Civilian Review Board, this is a board that's going to be able to work actively with not just the mayor's office, but with the police department and with the public to find out about these issues and complaints that are happening throughout the city. And how do we address those? A lot of times it's because of lack of training. And I think that's key. And the Police Accountability Bill did provide some guidance in that. So hopefully, you know, in the past year, I know that a majority of the police departments throughout the state have been purchasing body cameras. And putting in certain policies into place. So hopefully this will change the trend.
Alicia, I know one of your campaign focuses is on increasing mental health services. And when the caller brings up, you know, support for police, the ones that get grouped in with the few bad apples, something that doesn't get a lot of attention is the high suicide rate among law enforcement in our country. And I'm wondering how you would respond to that.
Yeah, I mean, I think we need to take a step back first and understand that the problems with policing, not just in New Britain or Connecticut, but throughout the country, is a systemic one. It is not an individual one. So that's the first thing that I want to point out. I understand that there are good people in every profession, but the fact of the matter is, what are we doing? We're telling someone, you get 6 months of training, then I'm going to give you a gun, and I'm going to give you the power to arrest, and I'm going to send you into a community. Oftentimes, the officer is not even from our community. And I think the worst and most concerning part is we try to send police to deal with all of our social problems. And I can imagine how that could have a toll on the individual when we're sending police for mental health calls, domestic calls, neighborhood disputes, quality of life calls. We have to step back and think. Do we really need a person with a gun and a badge for this function? And if not, why are we sending someone who's not qualified or trained to deal with these issues? So I think if we really want to help individuals have less stress, we need to stop throwing all of our social problems at them and start rethinking public safety. You know, start thinking about an unarmed mental health intervention team, domestic violence intervention teams, other resources, other programs, other ways to deal with these issues so that we're not just sending a police officer who only had 6 months of training with a gun and a badge to solve stuff that they're just not equipped to solve and not trained to solve. And I think that's the biggest problem here. We need to go back, look at the system and figure out how the system is working and whether it's useful to even have police respond to certain types of calls.
You're hearing Alicia Hernandez-Strong here on Where We Live. She's one of the candidates on the Democratic mayoral primary ballot for New Britain, September 14th. State Representative Bobby Sanchez is also here. He's a Democratic Party's endorsed candidate in that race. If you live in New Britain, here's your chance to ask these candidates questions before you vote September 14th. 888-720-9677. That's 888-720-WMPR. We'll be back after a short break. This is Where We Live on Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchel. My guests today are mayoral candidates on the Democratic primary ballot in New Britain, September 14th. Alicia Hernandez Strong, and State Representative Bobby Sanchez. If you have a question and you're a New Britain resident, 888-720-9677, or find us on Facebook and Twitter at Where We Live. When we think about the local economy, we know many businesses were hard hit in the pandemic. One business that might be coming to a city or town near our listeners is a cannabis, whether it's a retail store or a grower locating in particular municipalities, as the state continues to launch this throughout the state and coming up with guidelines. And so I'd be curious to hear your perspective, both of you, on if you're mayor, would you welcome a cannabis shop to New Britain? Representative Sanchez, I'll start with you.
Yes. Well, I voted on the cannabis bill this past session. I had my difference in the past about the cannabis bill because I didn't feel it was equitable enough for people that regular folks that want to open business. But this one seems a little better, and I was able to give it a yes vote. Got criticized by some people about it, but hey, you know, I think it was the right thing to do. It brings in additional funds, not only for education, but for also mental health services. I do believe that if we, it would all depend on where within the city someone would want to open one of these dispensaries. I would have to sit down, really take a look at that. I don't want something to go into a very poor neighborhood. The poor neighborhoods don't get the recognition, so to speak, from these last administrations. They're ignored. And this is one of the platforms that I'm also running on. There's certain community neighborhoods that have been ignored, regardless, you know, not enough businesses, not enough work, the lack of even fixing sidewalks in those communities. It's just been unbelievable. So definitely would have to, would support it only if I know it's going into an area that is not going to be very poor area, and that it would benefit the city.
Before I ask Alicia the same question, you know, isn't the point of the bill to give economic benefits of cannabis to poor neighborhoods, Representative Sanchez?
Yes, it is. But I'm also concerned that once we talk about putting up a homeless shelter or social services, it usually all goes into a very poor neighborhood. And then everything else is ignored. No economic development. The streets are not even paved. I mean, we can't do that. We have to take care. If we're going to do something like this, we have to make sure that happens in other neighborhoods should also happen in these poor neighborhoods. And so that being said, you know, I would support something like that. And it's going to be an economic help to these poor neighborhoods. But I would have to take a good look at where exactly they would put up a dispensary within the city.
Alicia Hernandez-Strong, what's your take on cannabis in New Britain?
Yeah, I mean, when I think about cannabis in New Britain, I think about the ways that our community have been disproportionately targeted by the war on drugs in the last 30 years. I think about all the people that I know, some of them my family, some of them friends, who have been funneled into the prison system over this plant that is actually less dangerous than alcohol. And it's really deeply disturbing. I would definitely welcome cannabis establishments. My big caveat is to ensure that it is adult use, that it is away from kids, that kids don't have access to it, that it is strictly for adult use and adult use only. So there's already provisions in the bill to keep it away from schools. So those would be most important to me. But in terms of revenue and in terms of small businesses, I would love to see people and families who are impacted by the war on drugs be able to benefit from cannabis. I would love to use the funds that the city is able to get for cannabis to help undo some of the harms from the war on drugs. There are a lot of people who can't get jobs. There are so many things that go into that. So making sure that the revenue is going back into these specific neighborhoods that have been over-policed and targeted in the war on drugs, I think would be the most important thing for me, and then keeping it away from children. But I definitely support cannabis establishments in New Britain.
We just have about 4 minutes left. So with this next question, I'll ask both of you to answer it concisely, but be, you know, we definitely want to hear your thoughts. Christiana tweeted at us that she lives in New Britain and there's a lot of community division, especially in the last year, both within the party and the city as a whole. And so Representative Sanchez, if you're elected mayor, how would you handle that community division?
Well, I would bring people from the community to the table. I bring all stakeholders to the table. I mean, this is one of the issues that we're having now with this current administration. There is a lack of communication. You know, they leave out some of the poorest communities in the city of New Britain. I live in one of those poor communities and have been living in one of those poor communities for many, many years. And I see no kinds of communication coming from City Hall. The North Oak area in New Britain is constantly ignored. I fought to bring in $1 million of bonding for the Martin Luther King Corridor project, which we hope we can get off its feet as soon as possible now that the $1 million in bonding for planning has been approved. But that's a project that the current mayor has not embraced. Mm. So, you know, with these communities, we really need to focus, get into those communities, talk to the people. I'm a candidate that I'm willing and a person that I'm willing as mayor to go into these communities. I was born in Malachowski Circle, raised there for 20 years. It is a very poor neighborhood. And I went back there just recently to talk to people, and there hasn't been much of a change in that.
And thank you. Thank you, Representative Sanchez. Alicia, I want to hear from you too.
Yeah, definitely. So I think that the diversity of this wonderful community has been exploited by politicians. People like to pit different racial and ethnic communities against each other, make them compete for resources, for investment from the city. And I think this has divided our city very, very deeply. And we saw that in debates about the Columbus statue, the Civilian Review Board, and many other issues that came up in the city. I think it's time that we bring people together across race, across culture, and acknowledge that as working class people, there are things that we want. We want affordable housing. We want economic development for all. We want good quality schools for our kids. You know, we want police accountability. So focusing on those things that working class people have in common, I think, is essential. And my team is a team of people from every corner of the city: Polish, Puerto Rican, African American, Yemeni. I have so many different people. So I believe that I have the ability to bring all of these people together under a common cause.
Well, Alicia Hernandez, strong. And Representative Bobby Sanchez, it was a pleasure to hear from both of you. Just a reminder to our listeners, the primary, September 14th, in a lot of different communities. Today, we were talking about the race for mayor in New Britain. Good luck to both of you. And for our listeners, remember, local elections matter. Don't forget to vote September 14th. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. Today's show produced by Matt Dwyer. Robin Doyne-Aitken was on the phones today. Our technical producer is Kat Pastor. Back tomorrow.